short for this. Okay, so I'm Marian Panganiban, and I work for Grab, and I think most of you come from the policy or academic circles, and I come from the tech startup community. So my presentation would be slightly different or very different from what has been presented today and yesterday. So I hope that's a good thing. I hope there's a lot to I've been learning a lot so far in the presentations, and hopefully you also are able to take away something from what I'm going to show you today. So it's a great privilege to be in front of here. And so I was given the rather daunting task of talking about transportation, shared economy, data and technology. And each of this, I think, is worth at least a semester's readings and coursework. So what I'll do is I'll share some insights from our experience in Grab, and also some of the policy questions that we've encountered, some of the opportunities that we saw that haven't been fully realized, and some of the products that we've built. So it would be, so it won't have the same framework as the previous presentations, but hopefully it should give you a flavor of what Grab is doing in this space. So for those of you, I think not all, everyone here is familiar with what Grab is, especially for those who are not from Southeast Asia. So Grab is Southeast Asia's number one ride-hailing company. So right now, we're in more cities than any of our competitors. We're now in 132 cities in 7 countries. We have 1.3 million drivers in our network across Southeast Asia, 63 million mobile downloads. We have 6 research and development centers globally. So we've scaled, and we put premium on Southeast Asian talent. We've been recruiting engineers and cultivating scientists, science talent here in the region. Okay, so that's Grab for those of you who haven't heard of it before. Okay. So Grab puts a premium on these three things: so safety, certainty, and transparency. I'll give you a little backstory on how Grab started. So our co-founder is Malaysian. One of our co-founders is female, she's Ling. And she would work long nights as a consultant in Kuala Lumpur. And if you're female, you know how scary it could be to take a cab in the evening in Kuala Lumpur, in Manila, in Jakarta. So what Ling would usually do, she would tell us, is she would call her mom and say, "Hey, I'm taking this cab. This is the plate number. I'll probably be home in, let's say, 20, 30 minutes." And then sometimes to save off possible abuse from the driver, she would pretend that she's calling her friends or her mother, and in order to say, okay, that I'm actually, like, someone will hear if ever something goes wrong in this ride. So that was a very clear pain point for not just for Lynn, but I think most females in this room can share that. And there, given the technology during that time, this was about 5.5 years ago, there was already a way to track rides. There was already sufficient GPS technology that could account for rides. They thought there should be a way that we could use this technology to address a very specific problem, especially for females in Southeast Asia. And that's how Grab started. So we put a premium on safety. You know your driver beforehand. You see details. You see the picture. We also put a premium on certainty. You can share your location. You are the first app that allows you to share your location to your friends. And also, we were also the first ride-hailing company to show transparent or fixed fares from the start. And I think this is something that, as a regulator, this is one of those things that you put a premium on also. So this is, like, still an introduction to the to Grab as a company and Grab the app. So as I said, we're in 7 countries across Southeast Asia. And I would say it's 132 cities. It could have very well been 132 different countries. It's a very diverse region. Each city has its own regulatory concerns, specific needs. And given that, for us, there is no one size fits all. So we provide a relevant variety of services and for every transport need. And one thing that we also aim to do is to reduce the number of cars on the road. So we have multiple ways of sharing rides. So we have Grab Share, Grab Shuttle, Grab Hitch, Grab Coach. So not all of these are available in the Philippines at the moment because of regulatory issues. But at least you have Grab Share. And also you have delivery services like Grab Express and Grab Food. So as I said, no one size fits all, and try as much as possible to have local team members in each country who oversees and makes sure that you're able to localize the services that you provide. And given that there are a huge range of problems that we encounter in the region, and our focus has always been how to reduce the pain points of our customers. And the policy environment can either be an enabler of that, of solving that problem. It could also be a constraint that we work around. Okay, this is the constraint, this is the policy environment, and we try to meet the standards or exceed those standards that are being set. So we were given that not a lot of Southeast Asians, for example, carry credit cards. We were the first to develop cash payments through the app. Also that maps in the region aren't very well, aren't of high quality. We also develop our own services to address that. So at Grab, we're in a constant state of building and rewriting codes and testing products. So there's a phenomenon. So in the past, so imagine that Grab is only 5 years old and we've built this scale and also this range of services. And I think the point that I would like to make here is that the technology and the space is growing at a very fast pace. And the policy environment hasn't been keeping up. And there are instances wherein, given the pace of technological innovation, the previous problems or previous policy questions are now irrelevant, or the existing policy tools are inadequate. So you have to start that conversation with regulators. And that's something that we, at least in Grab, we do our best to engage regulators in a collaborative way. So one thing I'd like to paraphrase from, this is quite an excellent book, especially if you're working in this space, The Half-Life of Policy Rationales, How New Technology Affects Old Policy Issues. So technology sets an intellectual half-life on policy. So, as I said, technology outpaces the change in policy, and it's for a good reason also. And one thing that technology can also enable policy change, it can trim transaction costs, and it can also expand the informational capability of government. So how can it trim transaction costs? It can make it easier to charge users. So for example, questions on, okay, how do we determine who's using the product? Questions on public, like how do you exclude non-users from users? So this is much easier when you have the tracking and metering technology. It's also much easier to define and enforce property rights because it's easier to monitor. It's easier to gather information, especially given the cloud computing capabilities that we have now. It's also easier to process that information. We have the talent, we have the capability. And it's also easier now to measure quality and safety. Things like this were very fuzzy to measure before, and it's also very difficult to put them down as a standard in law. But now it's much easier to like test that and see, okay, this is something that's working and this is something that's not working. And we do that constantly in Grab. We do a lot of small experiments to see, okay, what's working and what's not in terms of improving passenger safety and also the quality of our drivers. So it also, as I said, it expands the informational capability of government. So one thing that if you're a regulator, there's always that problem of missing information or asymmetric information. But at least given how things are developing right now, it enhances the technologies that are being developed and enhance government's ability to gather and collate and convey information and to monitor actions, identify transgressors, maybe not the government itself, but platforms such as Grab, such as Airbnb, are able to monitor that in case there are reports, and we do work closely with the police, with the land transport regulatory authorities across the region. We're able to track that, we're able to immediately address the situation. Imagine before when you would ride a cab and you wouldn't, all you had was like a plate number and you would call, I don't know, the hotline, and it would take such a long time before you're able to track, if ever you're even able to track the driver who did something, who abused you or something. So it's much easier also to enforce compliance. So I think the mindset that we would like regulators to adopt is that to see technology as a way to enable their functions to serve the people. Okay, so maybe I'll go now to some case studies. So one thing that we've introduced in Grab is what we call Just Grab, which is this industry-wide collaboration with taxi companies and regulators in Singapore. So if you're a regulator, you care about leveling the playing field. You want taxis to be able to access the same kind of technology and, let's say, passenger pool that ride-hailing companies do. This is something that we recognize in our conversations with the Land Transport Authority in Singapore. Also, one thing that we've learned, I think the question that you were asking here when we were building this product wasn't, okay, what did the regulators want? But it was more of, okay, what's the passenger problem here? What's their pain point? So we've learned that Singaporeans want quick rides and safe rides. They don't really care whether it was a taxi or a private hire vehicle. And that was the question that we were trying to solve. And in the process of learning about our passengers and also listening to the regulators there, we learned, okay, we can come up with a solution. And what we did was that the regulators there were also quite open to allow taxis to make their fare structure more flexible. So they also are able to set their fares, or like in Grab we have what we call surge pricing. So whenever there's an increase in demand, there's also an increase in the price that we charge. So taxis are also able to access that, or are able to be part of that scheme. So what the benefit there is that if you're a passenger, you're no longer tapping private hire vehicles. You're now tapping both private hire vehicles and taxis, which means you have a bigger supply pool. Your waiting time is shorter to get a ride. It also benefits taxis because then they have this access to a new market or a new passenger or a new pool of customers. And it also benefits regulators because then they're able to level the playing field. And this was, I think, a huge credit also to the Land Transport Authority in Singapore to have that openness to allow that scheme to take place. Okay. So this is to show you the scale of the data that we collected at Grab. And this is just for one city in one day. This is the GPS probes of our drivers for I think this is a day in 2016 in Cebu City. So this isn't even a map, this is just pings or signals from our driver's application. And we're able to sort of map the city based on that. This is Kuala Lumpur in Malaysia. So we're able to map the main roads and also the arterial roads because our drivers are going through all of this. And I think the point that I'd like to make here is that we are able to monitor listings, and these are, and if you're in from the government, it used to be hard to collect traffic data. So one thing, if you are lucky, you have CCTV cameras in main thoroughfares. And if you are even luckier, you have the cloud computing capacity to like translate the data you collect there into analytics to count the number of cars passing through. Most government agencies, what they do is they do manual time surveys. They send people out, count the number of cars, which is a very an accurate way of doing that, but here we have a more or less accurate picture of traffic into the city. So one thing we've done in Grab, given that I think this is a huge value, especially in Southeast Asian governments, where you don't have this capability to collect this huge trove of data, is we've partnered with the World Bank to share our anonymized and aggregated GPS data. So this is just a start of a partnership. The idea here is that eventually we're able to help governments across the region to measure and also assess their traffic situation better, especially here in Manila, where I guess all of you came in a little bit late or later than expected today, given the horrendous traffic situation. So that's, again, a kind of collaboration that we would like to promote with governments. And yeah, so another thing that we are doing is also testing driverless vehicles in Singapore. And again, this is under close cooperation with the Land Transport Authority there. So you have certain specific areas where you have what we call robo-cars or robo-taxis, and you can hail these taxis together with our partner, Autonomy. And these are things that we couldn't do, I think, if we were just a startup and just launching these things on our own. As much as possible, we never tried to do this because we also learned from the experience, is we have this collaboration with government. We work with them closely and we see, okay, what kind of areas, what kind of questions could we answer with our experiments, with our products. So I think this is still not going to happen in the Philippines given the state of traffic here, but at least in Singapore, we're trying to learn about launching driverless vehicles. Okay, so I think the key takeaways here is that we want to steer the development, is that we want innovation to flourish, especially in Southeast Asia, where there's so much potential. And there should be a premium on improving mobility, safety, and sustainability. We also want to integrate the features of ride-hailing companies and shared economy companies in general with existing systems and services in ways that leverage the new services' strengths and features. I think that most of ride-hailing companies have been cast into this rather antagonistic relationship with governments. I think for Grab, what we tried to change that, or I think we've never really taken this antagonistic relationship with government. We never saw this as like a fight. As much as possible, we want to work closely, as I said, with governments and also with the incumbents, like in our Just Grab product in Singapore. So it's not just a question of like disrupting the industry, but it's also bringing along the existing players along for the ride, and let's see whether our, and making the existing technology benefit all players as much as possible. So it's finding those win-win solutions. And it takes a lot of conversation with different stakeholders and also a lot of thinking in the product that we are building. So like after this, during lunch, I'll be speaking with the product team to hash out some ideas on traffic solutions for the region. And the last point, which I keep mentioning, is we want to encourage collaboration between the public and the private sector. I think this is how we're able to solve like really big problems of traffic, accessibility, sustainability. So it's still a very nascent field, even as a Grab, or even when you talk to policymakers, there's a lot of open questions. But I think the useful, one thing that I've learned sitting down in these meetings with different people is that it's like everyone wants to solve these huge problems. It's more of like finding those common grounds of conversation. And yeah, I think so far we're building the products and hopefully we can help move Southeast Asia to a better, more advanced place. All right, I think that should be it. Thank you very much.